בזה סיימתי לעכשיו. אני רוצה לעבור להרצאות. I want to invite Mr. Leonard Pottering to tell us a little about System B. Leonard? תודה רבה.
Okay, let's see. Okay, hi, I'm Leonard Pottering. I work for Red Hat in the Server Experience Group, and I'm one of the original authors and maintainers of SystemD. I will give a short introduction to SystemD today. I'm pretty sure that many of you probably already heard of it or even are already using it. I'll start with an introduction, but actually I would really prefer if we could turn this into a Q&A session in a way, because I much prefer if we can drive the thing into the direction that you wanted me to take it, rather than me just telling you that stuff. So I would suggest I start with introduction, and then if you have any questions or anything I say, completely do interrupt me right away, so that we can make this interesting. Okay. Yeah, let's jump right in. So SystemD, what actually is that? It's a system and service manager. That's how we define it. Like, it manages a system and it manages services. Traditionally, the role that systemd is taking over was something that was called the init system. We usually don't call it init system anymore because systemd does substantially more than a traditional init system does. An init system, of course, is the first process that the kernel starts after it finished initializing itself. So it's basically PAE1, and it's responsible for bringing up the rest of the system and keeping it up. The way we see it, though, as mentioned, is that it's not just purely an init system anymore, but more a set of basic building blocks to build a complete OS from, right? So it's not just one piece, it's now there's a full set of pieces that together build the basic parts of an operating system. A little bit about the history. We started with systemd in 2009. We made it public in April of 2010. And it was already made default in Fedora 15 in May. Wow, that's a weird typo. It's not that long ago, but it's in 2011, right? So nowadays, it's actually the default in pretty much all the distributions. Not really in really all of them, but in pretty much all the big commercial ones and the big community ones. The ones where it's not the default are probably easier to count than the ones where it is. Like the ones where it's not the default is Gentoo, where it's an option but not the default, and Slackware of the famous ones. So yeah, we kind of managed to actually convince all the distributions that this is actually a good idea. Which of course wasn't that clear that it would actually be an idea. Like if you followed the development of Linux in the past 3 years, you probably heard about all the kerfuffle there was about systemd and making it the default or not. Systemd, of course, is not a completely new thing. There was a lot of other stuff in that area before us. Most importantly, of course, System 5 init being the traditional Linux init system, since Linux was basically created. It was inspired by, like, System 5 init is actually a re-implementation of the init system of System 5 Linux. But it's actually unrelated to that. I mean, the name might be misleading there because people would assume that it actually was part of System 5, but it wasn't. It's a complete re-implementation by Linux people. System 5 init is very, let's say, arcane in a way. Like it's very original Unix stuff. It exposes lots of concepts that one might actually look at today and be surprised how simple they were designed. There is then Upstart. Upstart was an init system that was created at Canonical. It was supposed to do what System 5 init did, but actually bring it up to date. Upstart was actually great. Like the sources in particular were very well written. We originally, like the people involved with systemd, we actually thought that Upstart will be the future of init systems in Linux, but we bit by bit realized that the basic design of it is actually not how we think that an init system works or should work. So what happened to my audio? Everything okay? Okay, now it works. Now it doesn't. Everything okay here? Now I'm louder than before. Let me just continue. I'll just yell now. System 5, Upstart. So Upstart, we thought, was kind of the future of init systems in Linux, but the way it was designed, we thought, was actually backwards how we thought that it actually should look like. So basically, where systemd is a dependency-based system, so you actually tell it what should be started in the end, and then it calculates the dependencies and starts everything that's necessary for that. Upstart works the other way around. There you basically say, if this happens, do this. So it never actually calculates anything for you. It never tries to figure out what to start because some developer or some administrator told it in advance that it always should start that if that happens, right? The essence of that is actually that Upstart always maximizes what to start during boot, while a dependency-based system always minimizes, right? And it kind of pushes the work towards calculating what to start at boot towards the developer and administrator, because he actually needs to write down to this on this in this case. While a dependency-based init system, usually like you just tell it the final goal you want to go to, and it does the calculation for you dynamically at that very instance where you want to boot it that way. So, but Upstart, I personally think that Upstart, the soldiers are really, really awesome. Like, they're very well written, had tests and everything. I just believe that the basic design of it was not the way how it should be. So when we actually sat down and wrote systemd, we saw, okay, let's do our homework and let's see what other init systems are there. So we took a lot of inspiration from LaunchD. LaunchD is basically the service manager used in Apple macOS. It's actually a great inspiration because it introduced some concepts like socket activation in a way that was not known before. It's very Mac OS software in a way, but it's still a good inspiration. We took inspiration from SMF, that's the Solaris, I think it's called System Management Framework. It's a Solaris init system, basically. Or actually, it's not the init system, it's a service manager of Solaris. SMF was the service manager introduced for of course, big servers. So given that we work for Red Hat, and Red Hat's big business, of course, is servers, we saw, OK, that's the most important inference to have. And it's actually really good. SMF, in some areas, shows its origins from a time where XML was the greatest thing in the world, and everything had to be XML. But other than that, it actually has really nice properties. So much about really the influences. Let's talk a little bit about the concepts that matter for us while designing systemd. One thing is that we actually believe it must be modular, right? It should not be actually, like people sometimes, detractors on the internet suggest that systemd wasn't modular. We believe it's very modular. The difference, like in opinions on this, is mostly regarding how you define modularity. We think that what we should do is have this init system along with a lot of components, and these components are optional, and these components are implemented in individual processes. So we basically have more than 90 different processes in systemd. Not all of them run at the same time, but it's nicely split out into these processes. And you can, like, depending on what kind of a setup you have, you can choose different ones that you need and that you don't need. A server will, of course, run more of them. An embedded device will run less of them. The people who say that systemd was modular always complain about the fact that many of the modules that systemd contains actually do not run without systemd, but that's just a design choice to keep things simple for us. What also during the design for systemd matters mattered is that we actually care about alternatives, right? We are fully aware that we are just one piece of the operating system design, and so we actually care that you can plug in alternatives where that's necessary. Right. For example, systemd took up some components for does some work for logging. But we also realized that while our logging solution we believe is pretty good and does a lot of things that others don't and we think matter, we also are aware that other logging solutions do things that we do not do, and hence we should really, really make sure that you can connect these other logging solutions to ours. And that goes on. Like, for example, watchdog, like hardware watchdogs, if you know what that is. Sure, we implement that in systemd so that it's nicely integrated into the init system, but if you don't want that, you can run your own watchdog service, and it goes on and on and on like that. So basically, pretty much any component of systemd you can replace by something else, or run something else side by side with our component, get all the data. The only exception being actually PID1 itself, and UDEF, and very few other things. So let's talk a little bit, this is regarding the philosophy. Let's actually look at what systemd does, and specifically the basic concepts of it. So in systemd, everything is a unit. By unit, we basically say, like, encapsulate different parts of the system and then define a dependency system between it. So to give you an example, we have a couple of different types of units. Right, the most important one is foo.service. Like, foo is just some identifier I used here. It could be, for example, apache.service, or it could be Samba.service or whatever other service you have, and it encapsulates what you might think it does, which is a system service. So it's kind of the most important of the unit types. But there are other unit types. There's one unit type for devices. There's one, like, and devices, actually what you might think it is. Like, for example, hard disk is a device. There's one we call target. Target is a lot like a System 5 run level, if you know run levels from System 5. They basically are a grouping of other units, so you can actually enter a certain state, starting a couple of services in just one go. They don't carry any other information than actually having dependency on other things. There's a unit type of socket. This is relates around socket activation. I don't really want to talk too much about socket activation because it's probably a talk of its own. We have mount units types, which basically encapsulate mount points of the system. We have timer unit types, which basically encapsulate a timer that may trigger and then start a service. We have outer mounts and a lot of other stuff. Of course, I'm not going into detail in the more exotic unit types. Let's just focus on the fact that, they have dependencies. The dependencies are of two different types, so like two different kinds. First of all, they're requirement dependencies, which basically means that that service requires another service to run, or that service requires a mount point to run, or that service requires whatever else to run. And then there's ordering. Ordering basically means if this and that service shall be started, make sure that this one starts first and that one starts second. What's important to notice is that in systemd, these types of dependencies, requirement and ordering, are completely orthogonal, right? In other init systems, usually the requirement dependencies imply ordering, right? Like that you say, if I require, if for example HTTP requires my SQL, then it's usually in other init system means that also HTTP should be started after MySQL. In systemd, that's not implied. In systemd, you have to have two dependencies, one saying I require that, the other one saying I want to run after it. To actually give you an example of our dependency trees involving different unit types so that you actually get a feeling what that's actually all supposed to mean, let's look at this dependency chain. Right. So this is just one chain from a more complex dependency tree, just to give you an example how this looks like. Right. So multi-user target. So I mentioned targets already. They are like System 5 run levels. Right. They basically group something, give it a name, and you can boot into that. Right. Multi-user target is a little bit like run level 3 from System 5 init, if you ever played around with System 5 init. It basically is the target that is booted into by default on server systems. So multi-user.target hence depends on HTTPD.service, right, on the web server. HTTP.service in turn depends on basic.target. Basic.target is another target that basically encapsulates everything that is needed to actually bring up the system to a basic level without running any real services, but we're setting up all the most basic stuff. Basic target depends on localifs.targets. Localifs is a target that encapsulates all local file systems. One of these local file systems is /home, which is encapsulated in home.mount because it's a mount point. To actually be able to mount home.mount, you actually need to first file system check the file system that /home is mounted from. So you have systemd-fs/add-dev-sdh6.service. I'm not going to into detail what the add means. It's basically a concept of templates so that you can define one service and apply it to different, multiple instances. In this case, we need that, of course, because every single file system that's supposed to be mounted needs to be file system checked first. So we have one definition of the file system checking, and then we instantiate it a couple of times. In this case, we do it for /dev-sdh6. The FS check service requires the dev-sdh7 device to actually show up first, right? Now to read this, while the system is booted up, following this dependency tree, this basically means the dev-sdh7.device has to pop up first, right? Needs to be discovered by the hardware, probed, and then the driver needs to actually activate in the kernel and then tell you the space. After that's happened, we run the file system check. After that's finished, we actually mount /home. And we do that for all the other mounts. I left it out of this specific chain here, but just think that it's actually really a tree and not just a linear line here. Then after that, with all the file systems are mounted, we go to localfs.target, which encapsulates all the local mounts. Then we go to basic target. Then we actually start HTTPD. And after that's finished, we actually reach multi-user.target. Now, one thing that I might should have mentioned earlier, I think, is the fact that target units are, as mentioned, a lot like system type run levels, if you know them. But the big difference between them is actually that targets, you can actually have multiple active at the very same time, right? Like run levels and system file init, of course, are something that are exclusive to each other. You're either in run level 3 or in run level 5. In system E, that's not that way. You can have multiple targets activated, and you usually actually do, because, for example, in this case, in the end, you will actually have multi-user.target, active, basic target, localfs target, all at the same time at the end. Okay. The general goal is, wait exactly for what we need, right? We to be able to start an HTTPD service, we have all these dependencies that we pulled in, and we require them, but we don't wait for anything else. And we do this all like to minimize what we actually need to wait for, and then we need to initialize. And we do all that as parallel as possible. Of course, this one chain that I showed you here will not really illustrate how this all works in parallel, but just think about it, that if you have multiple mounts, for example, then you have more things that depend that locally fast or target that depends on to pull that in. Okay, so much about this dependency stuff. This is very superficial, what I just told you, but I hope it gives you a little bit of a feeling how this all works, that you have these units, and then you have the dependency trees, and then at boot time, we pick one of these targets and then determine what to start of that, and then we pull up all those units. Let's actually have a look how the definition, for example, for HTTPD.service looks like. But we'll actually pick another service because HTTPD.service is actually already quite complex. So here, what you actually see here is the definition file for a service called NumaD service. NumaD service was just some random service that was simple that I found on my laptop here. It's actually something for non-uniform machines, like some server stuff. What it actually...
Non-unified memory access.
Yeah. What like on the laptop, you don't need that, but it's anyway installed here. This one is really, really simple service. As you see, basically numad.service is how we call the units, and it's also how the files in the file system are called. Right? So in userlibsystem.e/system numad.service, you find the definition. The definition file is actually just a text file in a format that resembles Microsoft Windows INI files, if you know those, right? So you have these sections, like the unit with in bracket and service, in bracket install second, in brackets, and then you have a couple of settings. The unit section, basically, is a section that exists in all unit files, regardless of the type, regardless if it's a target, a service, a socket, a mount, a whatever else. And in this case, it carries only a description. Like a description is like a human readable thing so that you actually know what this is. And a link to documentation so that you can actually link up the unit files nicely with the documentation and find what it actually is about. Then the relevant part is here the service section. The service section actually carries the settings that are specific to this unit type, in this case service, hence it's a service section. And what it actually shows you here is XX start. XX start specifies the binary to invoke. Type equals forking specifies how this binary tells, or how the process tells systemd that it finished initialization, right? And type equals forking specifically means if you know Unix, you know this concept that daemons traditionally do double forking when starting up. If you have a daemon that does double forking, the double forking is a way how you can be sure that the service, the process is disconnected from the parent, and that the parent actually knows when the service finished initialization. For all these classic Unix daemon, type equals forking is the right value. I don't really want to go in detail what it really, really means, but yeah. And then the last section is about installation. It basically just tells us, if this service file is installed in the system and shall be integrated into the system boot, this is how you do it. In this case, it just says, installing into multi-user.target as a dependency of multi-user.target, so that when multi-user.target is requested, which is again the default run level for servers resembling run level 3, then this thing is pulled in. This output we actually generated with system control cat numid. To give you, like, system control is the primary command that you use to interface with systemd. It knows a couple of verbs, like system control start, starts the unit, system control stop, stops the unit. And system control cat actually shows you the definition of any unit you have installed.
This seems backwards.
What's that, sorry?
This seems backwards, the dependency. In the service, there is another target that the target should depend on instead of the target.
Okay, I think they told me to repeat the question, right? So the question was actually a very good one. He asked whether why this is actually backwards, right? Because in theory, as I showed earlier, the unit should always declare the dependency on something else. But in this case, we actually said that, we do a reverse dependency, that multi-user target should depend on this. And that's a very good point. And yes, it should be that way, but it's impractical, right? Because we install this unit file, and when we install the unit file, we want to make sure that from that point in time where the RPM is installed that contains the unit file, multi-user.target gains this dependency on this service, right? And the way we do that is basically we say, okay, in the init install section, we basically define reverse dependencies that shall be installed when this unit file is installed. Effectively, what actually happens if you have this section is that if you do system control enable and disable, which is the command to enable and disable a unit, it will actually look at this and then will create via a symlink a dependency from multi-user target on this one. So actually, it's just it's information that the installer uses to actually modify a multi-user target to add this dependency, right? I hope that kind of answers the question. But it's a very good point. Okay, so the question was how to actually inspect the system to see the dependencies of something. So let's open a terminal. Okay, so
can you change to a white background, please?
Okay, let's do that. How would I do that? you want it black on white, something like this. Does that work? Okay, so. So this is a command, system control show multi-user.target, right? Like if we want to see all the information that multi-user.target has, we use this command. And what I'll actually show you here is like it requires basic.target, and it wants, like requires is basically one of the requirement dependencies, as the name suggests, I guess. Requires basically is a strict dependencies. It basically says multi-user.target shall only, why did my recording of the screen actually end? That's a pity, I'm sorry for that. I actually was supposed to record that. Let's start that again. So this is a requirement dependency. It basically means that multi-user.target should not be reached unless basic.target has been reached first. Once is another kind of dependency. It's much softer. It basically says, pull this in. If this fails, doesn't care. Multi-user.target should be reached anyway. In this case, multi-user.target pulls in rpcbind.service, remotefs.target, system user sessions, blah, blah, blah. And if you go to the right, it actually pulls in quite a bit. Right, including cron and a lot of other different things, right? And then you can also see actually the reverse dependencies we created so that it itself is actually just required by graphical target. No, this just shows you the dependencies of this very unit that we selected, multi-user.target. If you want the transitional thing, there is actually a command. I actually have to
list of tendencies actually. Not that easy to type over there.
So this is actually the full dependency tree. So you see multi user target pulls in all of this, and then you see basic target then pulls all of this. So they actually have the full tree here, right? And there are a couple of other targets defined that do other things, so that's a full dependency tree.
Should we be able to see the NUMA target here?
Actually, no, because I actually don't have it enabled here because I don't have a server. But let's actually see. No, it's not in that. I hope this was useful. Okay, let's return, or are there any other questions at this moment? No questions? Okay, then let's, that one. Okay, so the question was, how does this play with traditional init scripts, I guess? So we try hard to provide compatibility, but we do not provide 100% compatibility. But what happens if you have System 5 init scripts installed, or LSB init scripts, is that there's a concept called generators, and these generators can basically extend the dependency tree of systemd, like the units, dynamically at boot. And there's one generator, it's like a tiny binary, that goes through the System 5 init scripts that you still have installed and turns them into native systemd service unit files, right, with the right dependencies, so that this foreign, like non-native configuration for systemd is turned into native configuration for systemd, and they're properly provided for so that you can actually have this compatibility. But this compatibility, we call it just 99%, because there are, like, LSB init scripts are very, very vaguely defined, and a lot of init scripts use constructs that are not okay to use according to LSB. Like, for example, they take additional parameters to the start command, right? Like, you can do you run the init scripts, type start, and then you can specify additional parameters. But that was never okay during for LSB, and we don't support that because we say, like, the services always need to start the same way, regardless if they are started by a user, by at boot, or whatever else. So, but yeah, we do provide compatibility, but we will never claim it 100%. And we cannot, because we aren't System 5 vendor, we are something different. But we really, really try to be compatible. The incompatibilities that we are aware of are all documented, right? There's a wiki page. If you Google for it, systemd incompatibilities, you'll find it, and it lists you everything where the LSB stuff is not compatible with systemd. In essence, pretty much all init scripts work out of the box, except for some. And these some are the more exotic ones. I hope this is an answer. There's a question.
Can I install systemd on a Red Hat 6 system or Red Hat 5?
So the question was whether it's possible to install systemd on a RHEL 5 or RHEL 6 system. I would not do that. You know, systemd is not an app you install on top of something. It's really at the core of the operating system. There's a kernel, and then the next thing is systemd, and it pulls in all the different things and integrates them. As such, it's inherently something that is a job for distributions to integrate, not for administrators and users to do. So my answer to that is yes, people can do crazy stuff, but this is certainly one of those.
So you don't have the right kernel.
Sorry?
Systemd is not a part of the vanilla kernel. What happens?
Yeah, no, systemd.
If I upgrade my kernel on RHEL 5.
Well, I mean, you can, so the question was what happens if you update the kernel on RHEL 5. That's not really related to systemd, but the kernel actually, you can totally do that, right? Because the kernel is a very tiny, well-defined interface, the system call interface and solution, slash system slash dev. But this is not, this is user space, right? This is not the kernel, right? It's completely separate. It's a system, the user space component. And you basically take the kernel, you take libc, you like take systemd, and a couple of other components, and then you build your operating system from that. Next question.
Speaking of the kernel, systemd is tightly tied in the one kernel, not supported in other kernels. Is that plan to be changed in the future?
Okay, so the question was that systemd is currently very much bound to the Linux kernel, if that's going to change and become portable. So the answer is no. It's very clear now. So with systemd, It is like what we really, really, really care about is that the Linux kernel is awesome. It has all this functionality regarding resource management, security, this and that and everything. With systemd, it is our goal to give administrators actually easy access to all this awesome functionality of the Linux kernel. And that means we will make use of Linux-specific APIs wherever that's a good idea. At least we think it's a good idea. So for example, cgroups, right? Cgroups, for those who don't know, is basically a way how you can take a couple of processes and put them in a group, and then the kernel will do resource management for them as a group. So you can basically say all the Apache processes are one of these cgroups, and altogether they should get at max this much memory and this much CPU and this much I/O, right? We use these cgroups in systemd extensively. Actually, every service by default is one of these cgroups so that it can apply resource limits. We use it for more than resource limits for killing things and things like that. But cgroups is inherently a Linux concept. But it's awesome. It's actually what you want to do on a server now, because on a server it really, really matters that you can do resource management so that you can make sure that if you run MySQL, which has very few threads, and Apache, which has a lot of worker processes, that they get an even amount of CPU, and it doesn't happen that MySQL it gets no CPU because Apache has so many more processes that want CPU. So for us, it really, really matters. We believe in a server operating system should have offered this functionality since ever, and it's strictly Unix, Linux specific, and Unix does not know concepts that could map to cgroups. Other Unixes don't know concepts really for that. Like Solaris has something called contract IDs or something like that. But on Linux, like on other Unixes, it's all very different. Like on Linux, you have this nice tree that you can actually arrange these groups in. But anyway, long story short, it's not portable and it's not going to change. And we have a very good reason for that, because we actually want to provide our users with the best possible experience and actually expose the stuff that has been available in the kernel for a long time to actually make it usable for everybody to use. Let me quickly see how much time I actually have. Okay.
What's your plan for kernel version? Like, how far back do you support, and how soon will you adopt new kernel features?
Okay, so the question was regarding kernel features, like what our requirements are there, like how long we do compatibility with old kernels and how quick we adopt new kernel features. Our goal is generally 2 years of kernels, right, which means 3 or 4 kernel versions. Right now we support much older kernels though. But basically, we try to provide compatibility as much as we can, but not more than 2 years. That said, all of the core developers, of course, work on the bleeding edge. So we sometimes rely on downstream to actually test this for us. To the question how quickly we adopt kernel features, we do that very quickly usually, but we provide fallbacks for most of the stuff so that we don't actually have a strict dependency, but actually take benefit of where it's available and where it's not, we gracefully degrade. We have a suspicion, though, that at the time where KDBus comes out, if you know what KDBus is, it's like this RPC system, that we might actually make a much stricter dependency, because it's actually a much bigger jump, and we really, really want that functionality. But in general, we try to stay compatible with 2 years. That's another question.
So my question is the rationale behind the
system. Can you be a bit louder, sorry?
So my question is about the rationale behind systemd. About servers, and for servers and for most of the desktop today, which is not actually a problem anymore. We don't have to go really good servers, all the desktops for that matter. Not to mention that when it comes to servers, we don't have a lot of services on servers anymore today. Specifically, you have a split between servers that run containers and virtual machines, and containers and virtual machines which only have one service, if any. So,
okay, so the question was regarding the rationale behind systemd, given that he thinks boot time it doesn't matter anymore today, because servers only run very few things, and on desktop and on embedded it wouldn't matter or something like that, right? So my answer to that is, first of all, systemd is actually not that much about boot time. It makes everything faster simply because it's more correct, but we never cut corners, right? like optimizing the hell out of the boot time. That's not us, actually. We are fast due to side effect of having a good design, but it's not really the primary goal. That said, we are way faster than everything that becomes that came before. But I also believe it's inherently important for servers, right? It's really, really important for servers. It might not be interesting for your specific ones, but it, in generally it is. And the reason for that is if you have high availability stuff, right, you actually need to get your machine up quickly, right? That's one side. But it's also with containers specifically. With systemd, you can do stuff where you basically have one container image that runs systemd inside, right? You can have as many instances of that as you want, and then you can actually instantiate them only at the time of a connection, right? So you can do these high density setups where for every customer, you say, you get a container, you get a container, you get a container, but you don't actually start any of them, right? But the first time somebody actually SSH into them or access via HTTP to them, you actually instantiate them and you boot them up. And if you do these kind of things, then you need to really be able to boot up quick, because it's basically the user should never notice that this node, that this container node, actually wasn't started before, right? And it's things like that. It's like it gives you speed. It gives you this ability to start on demand what before always had to start be started continuously. So yeah, I think it matters a lot. It matters for laptops as well. It matters for embedded like nothing else, because you have very little resources and you really should make the best of the resources you have. So yeah, if you come and tell me that it wouldn't matter on servers, I will absolutely say, no, absolutely it matters. It doesn't matter for all of them, but it matters for a lot of them. And it's highly important, especially as we try to increase the density and do things more on demand than always giving it up. I hope that's enough. I like the questions here, by the way. That's awesome.
What was the rationale behind the binary loss?
So the question was regarding...
I asked about the rationality behind binary logs.
That's a very good question. So, what we actually cared about is we actually worked together with the people behind RSysLog, or the guy behind RSysLog initially. So what we wanted to do is systemd is about service management, right? We think one of the most important parts of service management is actually logging, right? Because systemd might know that something has failed, right? Because a process died or the watchdog notices that it's not reacting, right? But you actually, after you notice that it's dead, you actually want to see why it's dead. And where do you do that? In the logs, right? So for us, it was really, really important. Okay, the screen recording turned itself off again. I'm sorry for that. So we wanted to do this thing where, show that, where we can actually show the last 10 log lines for a service when you ask what its status, right? So, okay, this screen is not small. But what you see here, basically, I invoke system control status. System control status is the one command you use to actually get the information about everything that the service contains. So it will show you information like the explanation where the service file is. It will show you that it's running and that it has been running since 18 hours, and the main process and all the processes. But down here, it actually shows you the last 10 log lines. And this is something we always thought we wanted to do, because we think, yeah, if you care about service management, you need to be able to show the log lines. So we need something indexed, because this command should only show you the actual logs from that very service and from nothing else, right? Classic syslog is not indexed. Classic syslog is a dump of text files, right? You cannot parse it sanely, right? Because you cannot, for example, it doesn't carry time zone information, right? It also carries very little information. It's not trusted, because you always have this problem in classic syslog that you can send syslog anything you like, and it will store it away on disk and never verify if it's actually true. So in systemd, we said, okay, we need something indexed. We need something that can carry structured data, right? Not just simple log lines, but actually metadata about who logged something, like which user ID, which process, what the process name was and these kind of things. We need that in a verified way, so we actually need to be able to distinguish the verified fields from the fields that are actually being supplied by the logging software, right? Like, which might be bullshit because it's not trusted. And so we said, okay, we need something different. Then we also had the other thing is like, we do init systems, right? And if you do init systems, a big part of what you do is early boot, right? We run in the initrd in the initial run list, which is basically the first part of boot after the kernel initialized. Then we do a lot of things like mount the root file system and transition into the host file system. Then we do a lot of other things. And eventually, we come to the point where we actually can start service. Traditionally, that point was where logging started on system 5 init, right? Because the logging server, syslogng, or syslog, whatever you called it, was a normal system server. It was very, very late at boot. Everything that came before that was not logged. So when we said, that's not acceptable, right? That's absolutely not acceptable because on servers, on desktop, wherever you are, logging is probably the most important in the early boot process because, I mean, everybody probably had an unbootable system at one point or another, and you care about those logs. So we thought, okay, we need a logging system that actually is around really, really early on, like the first instance of logging, right, all the way to the end. So, and then the other thing is we also saw that logging should be much more comprehensive, right? It should not just actually do the syslog stuff, but it should actually log STD out and STD off every service as well. So pulling that all together, okay, the last two things are actually more about why we created the journal, not so much about specifically about binary logging. But if we put all this together, then we thought, okay, we need something that is not classic syslog. Like some of these things I talked about with our syslog guy, asking him to support that. Some of the things he actually implemented for me, like, for example, I told him that he should make the PIDs that are stored away in the classic syslog file, that they should be made verifiable because the kernel can actually do that, and he did that. But all the other stuff, like indexing things for us, he didn't do, and collecting all the early boot stuff. So eventually we said, okay, they will not give us that because they don't believe that this is important. We believe this is absolutely important and is at the core of service management. And so we sat down and came up with a format that is inherently indexed and does a lot of other things as well. Like, for example, it has this cryptography built in that you can do things like forward secure sealing. It basically allows you to make sure that if somebody breaks into your system, that he cannot alter the already logged stuff, right? Like, he cannot hide his traces. And we did all this, and as soon as you want to do the indexing and the signaling and things like that, you cannot use classic syslog anymore, right? Like, the formats, I don't know after that. I hope this gives an answer, right? We sat down for quite a while, did the design there. We tried to basically keep everything as similar as possible to syslog. So if you actually query the system logging part, which is the journal, you use the journal control command, and if you type that, you actually see logs that look exactly like the classic Verilog messages looks like, right? Like we call it pixel perfect in a way, but it's actually not. It's actually even better than this because it will actually enrich the logs with lots of information that you otherwise don't have. Like, for example, it marks you the reboot, right? So I just typed journal control, it shows me all the old logs from 2013. And it basically showed, I rebooted.
And coloring.
What's that?
Coloring.
And it does coloring. Like, if we go to, like, this is actually not that interesting. It also has these nice switches. Because it's indexed, it can actually tell you, like, journal control dash B, it basically shows you all the logs from just the current boot. So if we type this, we see everything that starts up with the kernel logs. And then we have these wonderful coloring here. Like, for example, I mean, this is not particularly convincing in this case, but the kernel, like you see, this is bold and this is not. And the kernel basically gives us log levels for every log message, and we use that to color stuff. So basically, everything that's a warning in above, a notice in above, we put in bold. Everything that's an error, we put in red. And for some reason, the kernel thinks that that's important and puts it on a high log level. But here's more interesting. Like the red one, that's actually a kernel error. So we use all this information. What you don't see here is this time is actually time zone corrected, right? Because the classic syslog files, they don't contain time zone information. They don't even contain year information, by the way. So we actually always store the Unix time on disk, and then at display time, convert it to your local time zone so that you actually can make sense of it. Yeah, and the journal provides it with a lot of functionality. Like, for example, one other thing it does, it is able to interleave logs for display dynamically, right? And this is really incredibly useful for some cases. Like, for example, you have a container setup, right? So you have this server that runs 40 containers, right? And each of the containers runs systemd inside. Then each of these containers internally will also use a journal. But on the host, you can use this journal control -m switch. Because I don't have any container running, that's not particularly interesting this time. So you can type journal control -m, and it will actually interleave all the logs from all the containers and the host into one single stream, so that you actually have one command to figure out everything from the entire system with one command, right? This is particularly interesting because, I mean, containers are really about splitting up the system into parts, but sometimes you really want to know everything that runs in it, so you can do this kind of thing. And this kind of interleaving, indexing, it's all only possible because of a binary log. I hope that makes sense. I think I only got 5 minutes left. By the way, I have lots more slides, but actually wasn't my plan to actually cover them, because I much prefer it if you do ask questions, and you did that very well. So let's fill the other 5 minutes with all of those questions.
What's the connection of the systemd Linux system and the network? Why do you have a network?
Oh, network B. OK, so the question was what the connection between systemd and networkd is. Like, networkd is a relatively recent addition to systemd. It's supposed to solve the problem of networking, right? So as I mentioned earlier, systemd is not just really the init system anymore. It's like we looked at how systems boot up, and we realized that a couple of other things really think need to be there on pretty much any system you have. And then we came to the network. And the network on service, all the distributions currently use weird scripted things like this. There's on Debian, there's EF up down, and on Red Hat, there's another one. Desktops, and increasingly because Red Hat's pushing, is used network manager. But we thought nothing of this actually fulfills what we want it to be, because we care about booting, and we hence care about things like network boot, right? We also care about networking in containers, because we believe that containers should actually be not that different from a normal host, right? And if you look around, like, and also networking solutions have always been dynamic and react to hardware coming up and going away, right? If you look around, then none of the networking solutions actually provide that. Even though we think, like, network manager cannot run in InnoRD, cannot run in a container, right? Network manager is also probably not what most administrators want to use, but don't quote me on that. I think Red Hat thinks otherwise than that. So we sat down and said, okay, we want a network solution that is systematically better than what there is before. And we think networkd is that. Because like networkd works differently from the other networking configuration things. Like, for example, you have this concept there that you write configuration files, and they start with a match section. And the match section basically says to which network interfaces or which kinds does this configuration apply, right? So you can basically, with one unit file, say, write the configuration for all Ethernet devices that pop up, right? And systemd will, like a networkd will react to network devices popping up and apply this very same configuration to that. That's extremely powerful, because you can actually express things there. Where you say, I want to have an Ethernet bridge, and as an Ethernet device pops up, add it immediately to the Ethernet bridge. Right? You can even do more complex stuff these days. Like, you can express things like I want to build a router, right? And you have uplink and downlink stuff. Like, you want to propagate the carrier from the uplinks to the downlinks. And you can do that, because you just say, yeah, whatever Ethernet device shows up, this specific one is my uplink, the other ones are all downlinks. Now always bind the downlinks to the uplinks, and you get the carrier stuff. It does a lot of other things as well. Like, it integrates actually with firewalling, so it does masquerading setup for you. It actually carries a DHCP server. Like, it does it internally, actually. Some people then say, oh my god, why does it do its own DHCP servers? There already are many. Our reply to that is that DHCP is actually the most trivial protocol you can think of. It only knows three messages, like discover, record, and yeah, I don't know what they called it. But anyway, the one of the most trivial protocols ever. As hence, we thought that it's not worth actually having a demo. It's actually a DHCP server is more simple than a DHCP client in many ways. And we thought, okay, it's just the most basic addressing of IP that you need, right? Like, it's not something that should be a demo. It's something that should just be part of the normal addressing stuff. It's just One side is the provider, one side is the client, but it should just be there and should just work. And should be nicely integrated into the REST that we have. So, yeah, we saw, okay, and it needs to be in there. And like, if you pull it all together, like the firewalling stuff, the DHCP stuff, the masquerading stuff, and all the bridge support and things like that, it becomes actually incredibly powerful. Like, for example, for the container stuff, we carry two by default configuration files, one that can run, that automatically matches on interfaces that pop up inside of the container, and then another configuration file that only matches on interfaces that pop up on the host side of a container and that point to a container, right? The one side is automatically DHCP, so masquerading, blah, blah, blah. The other side is DHCP client. So if you put this together, you automatically get network configuration between the containers and the pop-up and the server. And it's fully dynamic, and you don't even need any central bridge or something like that, because the DHCP server is even capable of pulling an IP range, an unused, automatically and assigned to that specific VETH thing and things like that. But yeah, long story short, networking is awesome, and we think it's like, there are no computers these days that don't have networking, right? And as such, it needs to be integrated into the host because you have these things like iSCSI, because you have things like NFS, you should be able to boot in that. We need it really, really early on in the NRD, we need it in the containers, and hence we thought, okay, it needs to be existing. And I can only tell people, having a networkD is great. Like, if you do a server, if you do embedded stuff, if you do container stuff, it's I think, already the best solution you can have. And people acknowledge that, like, because the Ubuntu and the Fedora Cloud Edition now ship with networkD by default, and not enough network manager or the old scripts anymore. So it's not useful on the desktop, though, because it doesn't do Wi-Fi. But we're, like, eventually this will be fixed. I hope this gives an answer. And I think that was my time. So thank you very much. If you have any further questions, I'll be outside. And these questions were awesome. I really like that. Thank you very much for that.